Hello and welcome to another Overlord Lore video, and today we will take a look at what would happen if Nazarick would have been transported to the new world without Ainz Ulgaun inside. But before we do so, I say thank you to my Patreons for supporting this channel. And before we start, a bit of clarification. Some asked me if I'm on Reddit, Instagram or other social media platforms, and I'm neither on Reddit nor Instagram, and any other site I am actually on is linked to my channel. And with that said, let's continue this Overlord Theory video, where Evileye's bonus novel left us cliffhanging. What would actually happen inside the Great Tomb of Nazarick if they were transported to the new world without Ainz? In short, it would likely behave like one of those awakened empires from Stellaris, crossed with every endgame crisis ever, including the usual 200 years of lag. Sounds like a joke, but in the bonus novel, they appeared 200 years after the guild Ainz Ulgaun was re-established by Sotoru Suzuki and Keno, aka the girl that would be known as Evileye in the canon storyline. Now, regardless if this is the bonus novel timeline or the normal one, the Great Tomb of Nazarick would, at least for a few hours, not realize that something isn't quite right. But with their actualization as sentient entities capable of emotions and, in Albedo's case, thought processes far beyond that of mere humans, during the span of hours or days, Albedo would realize that Ainz is away longer than usual. And since Momonga was the only one who didn't abandon the guild, Albedo would be hellbent on searching for him, which would lead to scout parties being sent outside of the Great Tomb, only to realize that something went really, really wrong, and their entire location had changed. Albedo would then figure out that their sudden transportation into the new world and the disappearance of Momonga are connected, and thus Momonga didn't left, but was rather transported to another location. And with Ainz all gone, this would lead to Albedo as the Floor Guardian Overseer fully establishing command over the entire tomb. While the scout parties are scanning the surrounding, Albedo, as she is skilled in management and domestic affairs, will seek out Pandora's Ektar in order to check the financial status and make sure Nazarick has the money to remain operational. Alternatively, after the funds dwindle and Ainz didn't step by to throw in new money, Pandora's Ektar might initiate contact, after re-establishing a direct connection with the Treasury Vault and smacking Pandora's Ektar for impersonating Albedo's creator, Tabula Smaragdina. Since Ainz, unlike in the main story, isn't there to de-escalate, the dispute will end as soon as Pandora's Ektar learns that his father went missing. And this might lead to the first internal conflict in the tomb. Now, aside from the usual yandere punch Pandora's Ektar will have received, Albedo will want to head out immediately, while Demiurge, who's in charge of the defense and military affairs, will urge greater caution. But if Demiurge doesn't come up with an incredible good argument against it, Nazarick might head out in full force, very likely leading to the destruction of the neighboring countries. But back in the canon storyline, Ainz was able to determine that Chaltier went rogue, that she was truly dead, and later freed from the world item imposed mind control, as well as to determine Sebas's loyalty by checking the information screen present on the Throne of Kings. Something that Albedo might do as well, only to see his status as alive, or at the very least undead. With this vital information, Demiurge might manage to caution her, at least until Ainz Ulgaun's status change, which would lead to the second phase, mass surveillance. Albedo would send out anyone who is able to disguise itself in order to collect informations far beyond the initial scouting parties. Now, let's say Chaltier wasn't sent out on the abduction mission because Albedo didn't want her in the way of her own obsession with Ainz. Then neither the mind control of Chaltier happened, nor would anyone in the Great Tomb have prevented the death of Enri, the village of Karn, or Gazav Stronov at the hand of the slain theocracy Sunlight Scripture, which would mean that the kingdom on one side and the empire secretly aided by the theocracy on the other would prepare for the last annual war. And without the Chaltier encounter, the Black Scripture would be able to achieve their objective, preventing the resurrection of an undead dragon lord. This might mean that they just do that and then return to the theocracy, and in this case everything is fine. But if they run into one of the scouting parties, or worse, into Suzuki's newly formed second Ainz Ulgaun, then they would most likely be annihilated. Or similar to Suzuki's first battle against Kyur Elim, he would be the one to test the Black Scripture and then retreat. and if Ainz takes any damage, Albedo would likely directly head out in full force, leading to the destruction of the neighboring nations. But if the Black Scripture gets mixed signals and ends up invading the undisguised Great Tomb of Nazarick and consequently be captured, then everything might change. Thanks to Neuronist's information gathering, Albedo and the rest of the tomb would know that other players have appeared and that the slain theocracy is fiercely opposed against anything heteromorph. But since one world item already was used during this invasion, the denizens of Nazarick might be more cautious. Worst case scenario, Shaltir, despite never leaving the tomb, still gets mind controlled during the invasion of the Black Scripture, leading to significant losses in the first three floors, and to the end of the strongest floor guardian, who might be subdued by the other ones. Or Albedo goes straight to Code Red and activates Rubedo in order to deal with the mind-controlled Valkyrie. After that, they would reorganize themselves, strengthen their defenses, and finally retaliate. By that time, the annual war should happen, and instead of just devastating the kingdom's army, the Great Tomb of Nazarick will enter the annual war and wipe out anything that isn't them. After being mistakenly invaded by the Black Scripture in search for the undead Dragon Lord, they wouldn't take kindly to large military formations anywhere near the tomb. And in this case, the destruction of the entire neighboring nations could just be demiurge, establishing a proper perimeter. After all, if anything is destroyed within hundreds of miles, anything moving, no matter if living, undead, or construct, would be easily to spot. This would then trigger Suzuki and his new Ainz Ulgao. Well, new. This guild would be nearly 200 years old at this point to investigate this incredible destruction. And here it gets truly dangerous for anybody involved. In the bonus novel, Ainz had already investigated the destructions of nations and found Cur Elim to be the cause, and therefore he might be incredibly hostile against the undead forces of the Great Tomb of Nazarick. Likewise, the Great Tomb would be on edge after losing their last undisputed leader and being invaded by the Black Scripture with a world item. So in a cruel twist of fate, Albedo might order the death of her beloved Momonga, because she never heard his human name. Now, killing him and his friends of over 200 years will greatly enrage the newly revived Overlord, which could lead to him breaking the staff of Ainz Ulgao apart, effectively ending the guild. Alternatively, the scout parties pick up rumors about Ainz Ulgao far away from the established perimeter and question anybody what they knew about Ainz Ulgao before attacking them. You see, while Demiurge, the military leader, isn't exactly benevolent, he can restrain himself to a remarkable degree, even surviving a short conversation with Remedios Custodio without immediately burning her to a crisp. So it is likely that the scouts will find Suzuki heading to the Great Tomb, who will take a few moments to realize that there was indeed a first version of his guild some 200 years prior. This in combination with Keno and the rest of his new guild showing up at the doorstep of the old one will likely deeply dishearten anybody in the Great Tomb. Likewise, the new Ainz Ulgao might be absolutely shocked about the unprecedented destruction the Great Tomb had caused. But since Suzuki still was seeking for a cure to restore the Kingdom of Invernia, or at the very least, Kino's parents, he, despite just wandering through a wasteland created by his old guild, will have mercy on them and merely make the Great Tomb's denizens to obtain enough gold for Pistonia to resurrect anyone who has been killed. While the disappointed Ainz will visit the treasury vault, be disappointed again, this time by Pandora's Ector, and take out the world items necessary to lift the curse of undead Cur Elim had caused. Speaking of Pistonia, it is very likely that she will have been killed at some point, due to her alongside Nigredo desperately trying to save at least some new worlders from the rest of the Great Tomb's denizens, which again would disappoint Suzuki. So in conclusion, if the Great Tomb of Nazarick would have been transported without Ainz, they might be desperately seeking for their leader, only to be made to undo all of their atrocities and be sealed away in the Great Tomb, like Pandora's Ector was sealed away in the treasury vault, while Ainz spends his time with his newfound friends. And with this surprisingly complex theory video, that somehow didn't turn into a 10-minute long description of how everything got burned to the ground. I will end this line of thought. What are yours? Let me know in the comments. And with that said, thank you very much for watching. And special thanks to Adam J. Al Capone. Andy. Angel of Death. Bad Guy Yee. Boyzilla. Chrissy. Diabetic Centaur. Dystopia. Elika Birchleaf. Phaelis Katus. Gigafight. Ghost of Epicness. Hector Moreno. Hoss. Jason. Kleinator. Chromius. Large. Lord Touch Me. Lord Ulbert Elaine Odell. Majima. Matt. Matt C. Marcos. Mr. Shoes. Mindless Rev. Minnow 13. Mirtis. Primus 11. Sasuga Einsama. Sebastian. Shadow Lightning Wolf. Surge. Sparkly Unicorn. Vash Hawkeye. And Zogo, Bane of a Lot. Thanks, guys. Anyway, have a nice day. Over and out.